and welcome to this week's episode of On the Land, brought to you from the South Island Field Days at Kirwee. Rob Coate-Williams, original presenter slash producer, how does it feel to reach 100 episodes?
It's amazing, actually, because we've done it on a shoestring. And the most exciting thing is really that the team is so incredibly small, and yet we've achieved so much. And I guess the other exciting thing for somebody of my age is that people of your age have taken the bull by the horns and we've gone social media. Now, I have no idea how all this business works, all this stuff that you guys send out, but I know that it does. And the other nice thing is that my age group, who I seem to communicate exceedingly well with, are all very appreciative that we're doing Facebook and we're doing all these other different bits and pieces and YouTubing and websites and links and stuff. And they look at me and I go, yeah, I know. We don't need to understand. There's youngsters who do, and it happens. That's all we need to know is that it happens. So yeah, that's the real excitement, I think, about 100 episodes of getting information out to any screen, anywhere, anytime. And that's where the move has gone. The media is no longer television, radio, or newspapers.
Talk to me a little bit about how you got into On the Land.
Well, I'd been with CTV for 20 mumble years. And what before that, I'd worked for Television New Zealand as a rural reporter. And before that, I'd worked in Radio New Zealand as a rural reporter. So I guess I've done about 40 years of this sort of thing.
You're well and truly experienced then.
Yeah, I've earned my stripes, I think. I mean, if just with television alone, without the 5 or 6 years in radio, I've done something like about 1,300 and something episodes. And I had a moment when I got bored and I added it all up, and television in the last 1,301 whatever it is episodes, I've done somewhere about 10,500 interviews, which is actually a hell of a lot of questions.
Have you ever got bored during one of those, do you think?
I'm very proud of the fact I've never lost anybody. It's got pretty close on occasions. And there are times when producers took over and said, you'd make a great dentist because you had to pull teeth to get that interview, didn't you? And the funniest thing is when you know you've got 7 minutes to fill, it's the end of the program, and the person dries up on you. And the guy in the control room is saying, keep going, Rob. Keep going, Rob, keep going, Rob. And then they start suggesting questions and they say, ask him about such and such. You know, and the team, it's a team. It might be Rob Coate-Williams who fronts it, but I'm just the front person. I'm just the mouth, as they say. And really, I guess if I look back over the 1,300, whatever it is, episodes that I've done on both stations, it's not my program. It's the people that I interview, and I'm so, so fortunate to have the people I've got on. And to be with Tandem for that 100 episodes, absolute buzz, really is an absolute buzz.
Some people might be thinking, God, all those episodes, all those people, you must be sick of it by now.
No, I love it. I love it. I mean, as you were saying that, I think back about last week's program, and you know, about 4 or 5 times I actually cracked up, or I just sat there and I look at the person in sheer disbelief because they've just dropped an absolute amazing bit of knowledge onto me. And no, I love it. I absolutely adore it. I'm not so keen on all the sort of the writing up of stuff, because I'm not, but I write like I talk, which is probably a bit of a problem for the people who are reading it. But yeah, no, I absolutely love it. I love the people. I mean, you cannot get a better group of people than the farming world.
And it's quite special for you to be back here at Kirwee at near the 100th episode, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. And, you know, all power to them, because there's 30 of them on the committee and 30 young people have put this together. You look at the National Field Days, and I'm not kicking the boot into them, but they don't have demonstrations anymore. They don't, and it's an absolute marketplace, whereas here, the atmosphere is amazing. I mean, you walk in the gate at 7:30, g'day Rob, how you doing, g'day, no. And everybody's buoyant, and it's just, oh, it's an absolute, and you wonder why I do this?
And On the Land started at Kirwee Field Days, right?
It did, yeah, 2 years ago, and it was a brand new site, and they've, this little committee of 30, and I keep talking about them because they're absolutely astounding. They put it all together, and now they're up and running again for the second time. 2 years' time we'll be doing it, so again here, because it alternates with Southland. And shame about the weather, but Kiwis have all got boots.
Yeah, as long as you've got gummies, you'll be all right. Is there anything that you can think of off the top of your head over the last 2 years, I think, over the last 1,300 episodes and 10,000 interviews that really stood out to you?
For the last couple of years, I guess, there's a whole raft of them. And I had a feeling you're going to drop that on me, and I'm thinking, where am I going to go with that one? Yeah, there have been a lot of really good, and I think the funniest thing is that the old timers, the ones who have been with me for a long, long time, will always try to nail me during an interview. we had a big reaction to our accountant, Kerry Adams, who at one stage said that dairy farmers shouldn't get out of bed because as soon as they do, they're starting to accrue costs. And all hell broke loose over that one. That went international. That we were getting phone calls from people in the UK saying we had no idea it was that bad over there. And so, yeah, it was that was an interesting one. I think it's expecting the unexpected is another bit of the fun aspect.
Anything you haven't done that you'd like to do, I mean?
I'd like to get more involved with hands-on, I think, because I'm a wee bit inclined to stand back and talk to people. I love getting hands-on. I'd dearly love to start expanding a lot further out from Canterbury. A lot of our stuff is generic, which is Bute, but we do need to get into aeroplanes and disappear off and get our boots all sort of muddy up in northern parts of New Zealand and in the southern parts. That's on the plan. That's definitely is part of the very near future, which is exciting. It's fun. And the whole program is fun. The people are fun and the adventures are fun.
Well, congratulations. It's a huge milestone. We look forward to some more episodes.
Thank you very much indeed. And welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
It seems a bit strange handing over the microphone. But I couldn't have found a better person to do it.
Oh,
Tania,
lovely.
Thank you. Tony Davron, Hydro Services, you've got a hole in the ground. What's behind all this at the field days?
Oh, well, it's always very difficult to talk to people when you're standing on top of the soil about what you're measuring in the soil. So the best way to do that is to get into the soil. And so we've dug a trench, put some sensors in about where we would normally measure soil moisture. And we've got a couple of electronic displays that try and demonstrate how each of those sensors work. So how our neutron probe works, which is the red box sitting there on the top of one. And another one here which demonstrates how the majority of the sensors are that we use in the ground, how they operate and the fact that there's a wave that's moved through the soil to measure how fast it travels, and the speed at which it travels is directly related to the moisture content of the soil. So when you stand above the soil and try and explain that to people, they look down and give it a kick and say, well, that looks pretty wet or it looks pretty dry. But if you can actually get into the soil and show them where you measure, why you're measuring in the root zone, for example, why you're measuring below the root zone, and how they work, and how you place them in the soil it makes more sense when people see that.
Because it is a science, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely, it's a science. I mean, this is, you know, these are, even though the neutron probe or that technology is 30 years old, 30 or 40 years old now, it's still the state of the art. Nothing beats measuring soil moisture with a neutron probe, and the other instruments are cutting edge. I mean, these sensors are being upgraded and modified and get better and better every year. And there's companies all around the world that are putting a lot of money into research and development to produce the best sensor and take out the effects of things like temperature and conductivity or salts in the soil so that we get sensible soil moisture measurements.
Salts in the soil?
Any salts in the soil. So when you apply nitrogen, for example, if the conductivity rises in the soil, because of the acidity that's left behind, or you change the pH, then it affects the response of the sensors. So there's a lot of smarts go into these sensors to try and remove those influences when you're measuring soil moisture.
So when you walk onto a property, do you dig holes to see what?
Oh, absolutely. We want to go around and find somewhere that's representative of the soil profile that we've got. We're quite fortunate in Canterbury particularly, you know, most of it's covered by Lismore silt loams or something like that, and we know that it's only going to be 200 or 300 millimetres deep before we get 500 metres of gravel. So it's a matter of just finding that, making sure we don't end up on a stony ridge, for example, and are measuring something that drives irrigators nuts, because you know, you'd have to be irrigating every day.
Now, you're nationwide. How do the different regions differ?
Once you get into the North Island, we have, particularly when you get into the Waikato and the Pukekohe areas, we're dealing with clay soils there, real deep clay soils. Up around Pukekohe, the clay soils that are developed from the volcanic activity there from years and years ago. So very, very different soils. Very, very different approach to irrigation. Really, really small amounts of irrigation. Very low infiltration rates on those soils, so you've got to be very careful irrigating those soils. And all the way down to Southland, we have very similar soils to what we've got in Canterbury, but it's a completely different climatic environment.
Well, people would think Southland and irrigation burst out laughing.
Well, people think that Southland and the West Coast, for example, burst out laughing, but if you go into the Grey River, for example, or the Bullabin, up around Murchison, for example, there's a lot of irrigation in that area, and people would be very surprised that it's happening there as well.
So, reaction to the soil here, because it's pretty shingly.
Oh yeah, I mean, you know, we've got 300 or 400 millimetres of A horizon and silt underneath it, and then we're into the gravels that go down 400 or 500 metres.
So the mud's going to disappear.
It'll disappear. Yeah, a couple of sunny hours, and it'll be like a dust bowl.
Mud everywhere, so I guess anybody who's selling water blasters is actually in with a run.
Yeah, that's right. We could actually do quite a bit of money, or make quite a bit of money here washing trucks down at the end of it. So
tell me about it, because to me a water blaster is a water blaster is a water blaster, but it's not.
No, that's right. So we have a number of different types of water blasters. We have electric water blasters as well as petrol, as you can see. We have hot as well as cold. So just a combination of different types of water blasters for various different types of customers.
One of the things that springs to mind, I guess, is that machinery is now very expensive, so you want to look after it.
It is, and that's probably the biggest trick or thing that you need to do, is just to ensure that your machines are always clean, well cared for. And that's one of the things at Karsher in Christchurch that we actually have. We have a full service center there that allows us to take care of your equipment the way it should be taken care of.
And you're a national company though?
That's right. So we actually have dealers in every town, in just about every town in New Zealand. But we also have Karsher centers. So we have Karsher center in Auckland, Hamilton, Wellington, and now in Christchurch.
So have they changed much over the years?
Yeah, of course. I mean, there's just innovations coming all the time. One of the KPIs that Karsher has for the R&D department in Germany is for them to put out or apply for 150 different patents a year.
So that's 150
different patents a year. That's right.
So that's about three a week.
That's a lot. So they're constantly working on the technology and ensuring that it's just up to scratch.
One of the things that you think of is if it's too powerful, it's going to start taking paint off, but I guess you get the right thing for the right job.
And that's exactly what we do. We don't actually just sell boxes. We don't just say, look, let's get you the biggest machine. We look at what your requirements are, and then from there we actually work to ensure you get the right machine. So let's make sure that it's the right machine for the right job.
And I guess a lot of people have them in their own garage so that they can keep the car clean and the motorbike after it's been out getting mud on it.
Yeah, exactly. So what it is that we actually have two lines, and one of them is home and garden. So those you see in the smaller yellow machines, and then we have our anthracite gray machines, which are professional for commercial applications. So these machines that you're seeing here are basically just for the professional range.
We're just looking at the moment of those two big ones. What are they used for?
Those are two hot water machines. So basically, if you're looking at cleaning equipment, like you see up in our poster there, the heat does help to remove dirt, grease, from your tractors, and that's an important thing. Whereas with cold water, straight cold water, it would still clean it, but not as clean as hot water would do. So it's a diesel run boiler that heats up the water and produces the steam if you need steam as well.
So oil on a trailer, for example, I discovered, it's very hard to get off with cold water.
It is very hard to get off. So hence the reason why we use or we sell these units, hot water units.
And they're going well?
They're going really well, yeah. So we have a new cartridge center, as I say, that's just recently opened. We've only been opened for about a month, and we're pretty excited about it. It's a really large premises in Sydenham, so I would welcome everybody to come and visit us.
You could do demonstrations at the front gate, buddy.
We have demonstrations in-house. If you want to have a look at them, we actually have machines that we do in the building itself. So.
Well, everybody's focused here, but you're selling time off.
Well, so technically, some of the trips are more of a study tour, so we've got options for both, really.
So they're tax deductible.
Exactly, yeah. So, I mean, today's a perfect day for looking at escaping winter if you're looking for more of a rural holiday, but we do have a tax-deductible business trips, I suppose, as well. So,
So you've called farm to farm. Mm-hmm. That means that it's very agricultural orientated.
Yes, and we do customised trips for groups who have a particular interest, so they can be pretty technical, and then here we've got also general trips which have a good mixture of sightseeing and highlights and experiences of the countries with a rural flavour, I suppose. So
I would suggest that breed societies?
Yes, breed societies, industry groups, people going over to trade shows or exhibitions, etc., various things that appeal in that sector.
Hmm. Because travel can be pretty complicated if you don't know the ins and outs in the minefield area.
It sure can be, and I think that's a lot of people say to us that's what they enjoy about travelling with us, is that they sort of send the booking in or make the call and then we do everything else, mostly, and they just have to turn up at the airport and get on the plane and relax. So, yeah.
What sort of things have you been focusing on recently, for example? I mean, your combine harvesters working and people looking at small crops.
Yeah, I think at the moment it's a lot of people are looking at getting inspiration overseas and seeing how things are being done differently, and perhaps we're getting a little more of the paddock to plate mentality and seeing how things are being done and getting ideas. What else have we? I don't know.
Well, I would assume that you're able to get people in front of other people a lot better than they would ever try to be able to do it on their own.
Yeah, I think that's another thing people say. So we've got a great network around the world of colleagues who we've been working with for 20 plus
mumble,
years.
Yeah.
And so they do what we do overseas, and so they know the farmers, they know the breed societies, they know the industry people that our Kiwi travellers want to, the farmers here want to speak to, and they can get us in the door and have all the local ins and outs. So yeah, it's great.
What about locals here? I mean, do they ring you up and say, hey, listen, we are now doing this, and would you like to put us on your map?
Yes, certainly, because we have, so this time of year, we have quite a few overseas farming groups visiting, and it's always great to we keep abreast of what's happening around the country, and people love to see what's innovative and progressive in New Zealand. So, we've got lots happening here too, so it's great. It works both ways.
It'd be great for somebody who's got an operation on a farm to have a whole lot of overseas people turn up and talk
ooh
to them.
Nah.
Yeah, but also just to talk to them.
Yeah, that's right. And I think everyone's exchanging ideas all the time and comparing farming systems, but also lifestyles. And it's a great way to meet people who are living in other parts of the globe that do what you do. So,
what's the minimum group?
We'll do anything from about 10 to 30. We tend to limit them at the top a bit so they're not too chocker.
So it's one coach load?
Yes, one coach load with a few spare seats.
Some very exciting news from CRV. Tell me about it, Angus.
Well, today we've introduced to the marketplace a team of bulls that we've trademarked as low-end sires. What we've done is that, as everyone knows, there's a lot of attention around nitrates in our waterways at the moment, which is a challenge for all of us. And effectively, through about 5 years of research, we've managed to identify that the correlation between milk urea nitrogen, that's the nitrogen that is in the cow's milk, is actually a heritable trait. And if we produce less milk urea nitrogen, we believe that potentially there is an outcome where less N will be excreted onto the pastures. And the lower the amount of N that goes onto our soils and pastures, the greater the opportunity is to reduce the amount of leached N that ends up in our waterways. So if we breed bulls whose daughters then have lower milk urea nitrogen, we then have the opportunity to lessen the amount of nitrates that enter our waterways. And to put that in perspective, if today, if everyone used our low-end sire teams across the industry, the 2017 born daughters would put around about 10 million kilograms less nitrogen into our waterways. So that's a massive amount of nitrogen that did. And that's just through breeding, with no other sacrifices. So that's using genetics, using the fact that we've identified that there is a heritable trait in there that creates less milk urea nitrogen, we can have a fantastic opportunity of reducing the damage to our waterways.
So this is a gene that means that the kidneys aren't doing something, or how does it all work?
Well, so genetics is all about, I guess, genes, and this is a trait, so this is a heritable trait, which through research that our head geneticist Phil Beetson has done, he's managed to create what's called a breeding value. So we herd test, which is taking a milk sample, and over 5 years, around about 600,000-700,000 milk samples have been analysed by Phil Beetson, and he's been able to create this milk urea nitrogen breeding value. So when you do that, you can see ones or cows that have got high quantities of milk urea nitrogen, ones that have low. We then correlate back to their sire, to their ancestry, what sire created that lower milk urea nitrogen. It's a heritable trait. Phil then puts together the team of bulls around which the low N trait sits, low milk urea nitrogen trait sits, and then we then put those sires across the cows.
Is there any downside? Is there any trade-off?
I guess, look, that's one of the most fantastic things. There simply isn't, and that's why we've introduced it today. We do still need to do ongoing research, but there's absolutely no reason, from our viewpoint anyway, why farmers shouldn't start on a breeding program today that uses sires with low N.
Certainly going to shut down a whole lot of criticisms and critics, isn't it?
Yes, it will, and we want to put that in perspective. So what we're all about, and this is, I think, a challenge for every part of the industry, is being able to give farmers choices on how to make the sustainability equation work for them. And one of the things that they have to do is lower the amount of nitrates going into waterways. So this is one of the tools that goes into that toolbox of farming choices that they have about bringing through lower N entering our waterways, greater sustainability. And I want to reiterate, it's an industry thing. It's definitely a thing that does affect our dairy farmers, but this is better for the whole of New Zealand as well.
Anything that Noel Beetson's done has got credibility.
Phil Beetson?
Mm.
Everything that he's done
has got credibility.
Well, look, it has, and I guess we're incredibly lucky to have Phil working for us. But if you have a look at the history of Phil and what he's done for genetics in New Zealand over his working lifetime, it's absolutely fantastic. He hit upon this 5 years ago. He was the one who created, I guess, the idea around the research and development. He put up the reason why we should add, and it is a very simple addition, but quite costly, the milk sampling urea into our herd testing, so that we 5 years ago started taking this test. And that's all very much Phil. He thinks about the future. He's not breeding for today, he's breeding for the future. And we're incredibly lucky to have Phil working for us.
What about supply? How many of these semen stalks can you get?
Well, there's a limited supply, obviously, because we've just commenced this breeding program. But we literally do have hundreds of thousands of straws that sit in our stocks at the moment. We have identified 25 sires with this desirable trait. They're 25 sires that also have all the other traits that you want in your breeding program. So it's an addition, not a subtraction, to your breeding program. I'd love to think that the whole industry really takes us on board and adopts it, not just us. And I think the sufficient straws for farmers really to pick up on this and make a difference.
Well, congratulations to you. You must be very proud.
It's nice to be part of it. Yes, of course, you know, it's proud. We're delighted to be able to bring it to the industry. But at the same time, we're a breeding company. It is our responsibility to bring these things through. So, yeah, it's great. It's great for us, great for the dairy farmers, great for New Zealand.
The lovely things, of course, is the people that you meet at the South Island Field Days, and two gentlemen, and I don't use the word lightly, CRV's announcement, that's pretty good, William.
Yeah, I think it is good. And it does show that you know, farmers have really only been talking about nitrogen for 10 or 15 years, and we're already starting to come up with solutions. It really goes to the fact that if you, you know, farmers don't like being told what to do, but if you give them a problem, they like to solve it, and that's exactly what they're doing here.
And Tom, I know you're a great advocate of this sort of thing.
Yeah, I'm reinforcing what William's saying, but you know, it's the type of breakthrough that we need. As a regulator, giving farmers a bit of time to adjust, we need to know that there are solutions and that farmers are going to take it up. So I can only urge farmers to have a really good look at this product and see if it's part of their toolbox that will help us reduce nitrogen going into waterways to make our waters better.
South Island Field Days, how is the farming industry? Is it in good fettle?
Well, the first thing is I wish I'd brought my dinghy so I could actually get through the mud.
The carches are down there with water blasters. Well, you'll be right.
Yeah, I do think that there's a much better feel in the farming community this year than there was last year. And, you know, the milk price has got something to do with that, but I just think there's a bit more spring in the step of farmers, and we'll see if that turns into spending on the day.
I guess the Chinese people coming over and talking trade and TPPA still not totally off the blackboard.
Yeah, I mean, we've got some real headwinds in terms of international trade, but you're right, TPP is not off the, you know, it's not a dead duck. There's TPP11, as they're calling it now, and you know, China's taking a big interest. I'd be pretty concerned if I was the United States. Looking at their regional influence, because they're taking a back seat, they're being isolationist, and if they continue to do that, then they will become less relevant, and I think that's a concern for them.
And Tom, you're getting mud on your boots again.
I am, but there's two things. Just going back to that Chinese visit, that ability to put chilled meat into the Chinese market is a fantastic opportunity for value add. And I guess one of the frustrations with a lot of the things that we hear around trade is people just don't understand that if we actually can free up markets overseas, then we can actually add a lot more value to New Zealand produce and really get this economy humming. The other thing that's great about the field days, this is just bringing all of those industry players that help us as farmers use our resources much more efficiently. And you know, just you know, to be here in this treasure trove of technology and understanding is just fantastic, because we've got to get across that farming, it's high tech, it's biological, and it's actually a wealth creator, and it's really just neat to be here.
Science, this is science now.
Yeah, science is absolutely critical, and it's the most critical thing is that farmers actually have access to all the tools and modern technology to be able to do the things that they need to do to address issues like climate change and water quality, etc. So, you know, there's a huge amount of technology here today. We're in the middle of the digital revolution, and it's my view that we're on the cusp of the biological revolution. So we're going to see some incredible things happening in genetics, and we've seen one today already. But there'll be other tools that come along that are going to be really necessary for farmers to use, and I'm looking forward to those.
Trees and electricity don't mix, do they?
You're dead right, Rob, they don't. And we have a lot of difficulty with trees in storm conditions, wind conditions, people not maintaining their trees as they're required to. We're here representing Main Power, Orion New Zealand Limited, EA Networks and Alpine Energy Limited. We all have in the Canterbury, Greater Canterbury area, a big issue with trees around our lines and the management of those trees. And it's the requirement of the landowners to manage those trees, but we try and assist as much as possible.
Because it's wind and snow.
Correct, yeah. So you could have your tree trimmed lovely on a nice sunny day, The moment we get a couple inches of snow, that drags that tree branch right down into the lines and even crashing on the lines and pulling our lines down, yeah.
People who plant trees under power lines really need to be talked to?
Correct, yeah, and we actually offer alternative varieties of species to plant under lines, and typically they're more of the indigenous type of tree, which don't grow like poplars and pines and gums and those sorts.
It is a major problem. Do the farm owners actually have any liability?
When yes. Yeah, they do. There is tree regulations out there, and that spells out that the landowner is the responsible person. But we, as all the companies, try and assist to make it easier for him and give advice, drop a hat any time, just because it assists us as well.
Because you want to be mates, not police people.
Dead right, yeah. And we want to get alongside people, help them out where we can. Yeah, we don't want to be there 3 a.m. putting up our lines.
Because the bottom line is that somebody being selfish is likely to put the whole neighbourhood out.
Correct. I mean, the lines go for dozens and hundreds of kilometres, and your tree could put out 30 or 40 or 100 kilometres of line, and everyone down the line from you has got no power.
And they're looking for the person whose tree it was.
Yes, yes. And we do. Yeah, and we try and assist them and make sure it doesn't happen again.
Simple rules. Have we lost the touch of common sense?
No, it's something that's been around for ever since there's been power wires and trees in the Canterbury Plains, and I think things are definitely getting better. People are becoming far more responsible, and it's assisting everybody.
Let's talk a wee bit as we sort of wander over about some of these electric vehicles, because yeah. I'm absolutely astounded how far we've come. When you look at the oldest one in New Zealand.
Yeah, we want to talk about electric vehicles because they are becoming a hot topic in the community now. And just to show that the vehicles, electric vehicles have been around for a long time. We have a car here built in the United States in 1904, fully electric. And we this is owned by a gentleman in Christchurch. And then we have our old truck from the MED, which was bought by the MED in 1919. And there was 200 of these vehicles in the Christchurch in the 1920s. So electric vehicles are not new, are they?
Well, let's have a look at some new ones.
So over here we've got Nissan Leaf, which is a fully electric car. And this is an example of one of the many, many type of fully electric cars available around on the market now. This one's owned by Main Power. And of course you have a lot of the vehicles that are dual fuel and dual and electricity.
That hybrid, is it?
Hybrid, the hybrid cars. Yeah. Well, this one is fully electric.
And this is the thing of the present, not the future?
This is the thing of the present, not the future. No, this in a few years, in a very short time, this will be almost a vintage before it gets old enough to be a vintage.
Tell me about the map.
Okay, the map there is just to highlight the area that we're representing and a few of the points. And we try and we have a few of these little QR codes that'll take you to the people's safety pages on how to work around lines, what to do for tree planting. If you're digging in the ground, there's cables in the ground, how to find out about that. So it's a whole safety package, really.
Are people catching on? Because it's a very big campaign to say, look before, check before you dig.
Yes.
Are people learning?
Oh, I think so. But we're better than what we were. But of course, in Christchurch, we're still in that recovery stage, and there's a fair and rebuild stage now, and there's a fair bit of digging going on, more so than what there'd normally be, so consequently we get a lot more hits on the lines than we normally would.
And you hear tragic stories about fatalities because of irrigation pipes and overhead lines. People get caught easily.
Yeah, thankfully we haven't had anything of recent times, but yeah, definitely a danger in lines, and hopefully like the Federated Farmers and those sort of organisations have assisted farmers as well as us to make sure they set up the irrigation runs far enough away from the lines they don't have that issue. Also is how we assist the guys when we build the lines on their properties to make sure that they don't get built over the middles of paddocks and stuff like that where their irrigator's going to be.
Take home message, I guess it's think before you do anything.
Yeah, think before you do anything. Looking up for shifting elevators, augers, trucks, stock trucks, irrigation lines, looking down, thinking about wires in the ground, cables in the ground. If you're digging up, putting pipes in your farm, you may have underground cables. That's the whole gambit, really.
And trees. major, major take-home messages.
Yep.
Keep them clear.
Dead right. Trees keep growing 24/7. They don't stop growing. And especially some of the exotic species grow real fast. So they've got to be really got to keep an eye on those.
So people can actually give you a ring and say, hey, listen, can we talk to you about these trees?
Yes, definitely. Yeah, all of the network companies are very happy and would love to be approached by homeowners and landowners around their trees, and we can offer all sorts of assistance around how to manage that.
But you don't want to start taking off branches that are going to take the lines out.
No, but there's ways to manage that, and there's rules around how they can work within the line, so it can all be done safely.
One thing you can guarantee is wherever you go at the South Island Field Days Kirwee, there's got to be noise, and there's a lot of tractors that are making a hell of a lot of noise out there. But let's talk about insurance if we can, because it's a very specialised art now, isn't it?
Well, it certainly is becoming with climate change and everything coming on board. So we've got droughts, we've got fires, we've got all those type of things coming around. We recently had the fires on the hills and so on. So it is becoming quite a specialised, especially in the rural area. Like I said, with the recent fires and so on, we lost quite a few sheds and one property totally lost and so on. So when there's quite a few elements towards that, so especially with the firefighters, we had about 21 helicopters in the air, and they all need to be paid and so on. So there's quite a lot of elements to the insurance part of it, and there's quite a few people out there that still don't understand the insurance part of it, especially with paying the firefighters and the helicopters and all of that. So they get a quote for the insurance over the telephone, and it doesn't actually pay for what it should be paying for, that's quite a concern going forward.
Because even if a property owner doesn't actually start the fire, they can still be
liable for it. Yeah. So basically, what the fire brigade and everybody is saying is that even if they prevented the fire to get to your property, you'll still be pinged with a bill to pay for their services.
So if it doesn't get to your property, but it's heading there.
Yeah. So it doesn't get to your property and it's heading there. They take a perimeter around it, and everybody within that perimeter pays the bill. So you'll just get a bill within in your mailbox and say we prevented the fire to get to your property, and there's your bill. You need to pay fork an amount out. Now that is insurable under your Forest and Fires Act cover in your liability package, but if you are liable for the whole bill of it, then the normal $250,000 is not going to cover it.
Well, if you've got 9 or 10 helicopters in the air at $900 and something an hour.
An hour, that certainly only takes about 4 or 5 days for them to put it out, and it takes another week or so to actually just get the hotspots away. That all wraps up to quite a hefty bill.
So how much are people putting as their extension for public liability? It must be a couple of million?
Well, yeah, we recommend, and this is something that Aon really is proud of, and that we recommend, and we make sure that not one of our clients has less than $1 million of cover. You never know that if a fire, whether you're negligent or it starts on your property and it goes and you get the full bill. I think 2009 there was an issue in Nelson where a lifestyle block went and took out ash at, the next morning, wasn't cooled down, burned down the neighbor's farm. That was 1.25 million if I'm correct. The whole fire fighting bill was 1.2 million. They only had $250,000. They literally had to sold their farm to pay that bill.
It bankrupted them.
That literally bankrupted them. And they went to court. The High Court just said, sorry, you need to pay it.
So on top of that, you've got insurance for your buildings.
For your buildings. So you have your normal assets policy, your material damage policy that covers your assets. So your house, your sheds, all of those type of things that is on the farm. This is just on top of all of that.
Crop insurance, can you cover crops?
Yes, crops can be insured. It is a whole different type of insurance and so on, but fire, flood and hail and those type of things can be insured for crops, yes.
And I guess your team and representatives and agents like to do a every 12 months a bit of a review?
Well, we try to get at least every 6 months to our clients and so on, and just say, hey, how's it going, what you're doing, what changed, what's happening in the future and so on. And we've got about, just in Canterbury, we've got 20 rural brokers that only does rural insurance. In Canterbury, doing exactly that, going out at least every 6 months or 12 months out, sitting down and revising everything.
Because you, as an industry, keep revising, so people can't be expected to keep up.
No, well, like I say, it's an ever-evolving and changing industry, especially in the insurance. And we do have a team that sits every 3 months or 6 months to revise policies. And see what is different out there in the market, what can we do different. Aon is now on the verge of bringing out a whole new rural policy to the rural market that is totally different to what the normal is out there.
If you've got staff, you've got problems, whether you're hiring them or trying to move them on. And Warren, I think it's probably one of the hardest areas of any farmer is the HR or human resources.
Yes, it's certainly a challenge. Staff, well, like most human beings, are a little bit fickle. They can do some unusual things and create all sorts of challenges. And I suppose one of the best things around that is to put some good structure and processes around the hiring, actually detailing what their jobs are, and putting some good processes in place.
Getting the right people for the right job.
Absolutely. You know, it's the wrong person can end up costing a lot of money long term. You might pick them up nice and cheaply at the start, but when you find they actually can't do the job or can't do it properly or create damage around the farm, to your gear and things like that, it actually ends up costing a lot of money. So sometimes it's a little bit better to put some really good process around the selection and of the staff, and then in structure around the job positions as well.
One of the problems that I've encountered is that somebody comes on as a staff member, then you find out that they're using drugs and goodness knows what.
Yeah, absolutely. It's one of those things that they're pre. Employment selection process is hugely important, right from doing the referee checks to make sure that what they're claiming is actually what is reality and the truth, and then looking at pre-employment drug testing so that you know that they are clean at least when they arrive with you, and then perhaps look at the ongoing drug testing to ensure that they stay that way and that it wasn't a one-off that they did prior to starting.
One of the interesting things, I guess, is that farmers will have a very close relationship with workers, and they will be very loath to do drug tests and whatever.
Yes, I suppose there is that element, you know, the relationship thing comes first, or that what's seen as the personal relationship is probably important to them. But then again, you know, if you get it wrong and they are affected by substances of any kind and you have an incident on farm, it becomes a health and safety matter as well, and if they have been under the influence of something when the incident happens and it's found to be that way post incident in an investigation, then you can be liable for some of that outcome as well.
You can be liable
as the employer for allowing that in the workplace, particularly if it's had any past and contributing to the incident, which it's hard to argue against.
Well, I mean, it is a minefield.
Yes, absolutely. It's like any employment process, it can be a minefield, and that's why it's good to perhaps select some professional help in getting the processes right before you set off and employ somebody. And then go through the process properly after that, and that's that. Looking at the referee checks, actually ringing and contacting referees, and doing the pre-employment drug testing and those things, and just making a really good job of it. Do it properly. It's, after all, you know, it's your business that's liable to suffer if you get it wrong.
Well, and the other important thing is that you're able to do the exit plan, because once again, farmers are getting burnt real badly.
Yeah, look, it's when you staff have to be exited for poor performance or because they've just don't fit in or whatever it might be. If it's not done properly, again, it can end up costing the business significantly. Not just pure monetary forms, but time as well. If it's taken through the employment court process and things like that, you can end up getting burnt badly, both financially and in time investment. It's something that you have to get right. There are legislations dictated some steps that need to be taken and followed to do it properly and removes those that need to be removed.
Sadly, there is people out there who sound very good at the interview and are professionals at taking 10 grand to pop off employers.
Yeah, I think, well, it's, you know, there's certainly anecdotally there's some individuals out there that probably make a better living out of taking employers through the employment process and getting grievances payouts than what they do through their salary or wages. And again, you know, that comes down to following process and getting the process right, and that lessens your exposure to risk of falling foul of the employment court process.
Good cop, bad cop.
Something like that.
A little know-how can save a lot of heartache. Pauline, that's referring to what?
It's keeping children safe with dogs. And really it started out by me walking my girl there and having children rush up and throw their arms around her and wanting to pat. And I was really quite horrified, but what really concerned me even more was the attitude of the parents that really just said, their child loves dogs. And I thought, well, gosh, that could change in a heartbeat had it been a dog that wasn't well socialised and with a good temperament. So I started and created two books for children, kindergarten age and primary school age.
Dogs get a fright. Wow.
They do. They react. And I hear all the time where people say, you know, always supervise children when they're with dogs. But unless the adults actually know what to look for, the signs that the dog is saying, I'm uncomfortable with this, I would like to go away, they don't know. And the dog is really only reacting the only way it knows how.
Well, then youngsters who have got a dog that knows them,
yes,
meet a dog that doesn't know them.
We find that the majority of bites, unfortunately, are by dogs that the children know.
Really? I wouldn't have thought that.
Yes, it is. It's in the home, it's the family pet that the child constantly teases and the dog can't get away, and just that's how it knows. And it does give off signs that a dog is unhappy, where they will give this little lip lick and they yawn, which is a diffusing, trying to calm situations down. They turn their head away to say, I don't like what's going on over here, I want to go away. But if they can't get away, then, you know, they growl, or the last resort is a little nip to say, I can't cope with this situation anymore. And yeah, so, and that's across the board. This is farm dogs as well as town dogs.
So you're warning the adults, as in parents, as well as the children, educating both.
I'm trying. And that was the wonderful thing that I, wonderful feedback that I got with the first book that I wrote for the children, was the parents were learning too, because they were reading the book to the child. And so the parents said to me, I didn't know that dogs don't like being patted on the head.
They don't?
They don't, no. So if you can imagine being a dog down here and somebody walks along and they come forward and put their hand out onto the dog's head, the dog, all the dog sees is a hand coming down towards them. So really the best thing to do is to let the dog approach you rather than you going to the dog, and just let them sniff your hand, and if they do that, turn your hand over and just gently stroke under their chin, and that's it. I mean, think of it from a person. When you meet a stranger, you don't walk up and give them a hug. You stand a respectful distance and shake their hand. So that's what we're saying to the children. Give some space, stand back, and if the dog wants to come and say hello to you, it will.
Are you winning?
I'm really passionate about this, and I will just keep going and keep going, because every one book that is out there, I hope, is going to save one child from being bitten.
So, okay, how to keep kids safe with dogs and keep me safe keep to me the books.
Yes.
Hold those up for us. Where do we find those?
Rural women have really embraced the opportunity to help support this, and they're online at the Best Little Bookstore or for teachers at Wheelers, or they can come to me direct.
Are they going out? Are people buying them or
absolutely,
getting hold of them?
Absolutely, yes. This book here is in the third edition, and we have just about sold out of that, so hopefully there will be a fourth edition coming up later this year.
You're a one-woman campaign?
No, I'm not. I feel like it at times, but there are groups. There's a wonderful group called Bark New Zealand in the North Island that go out and go into schools. And of course, animal control throughout the country. They are a council organisation, they do their best, and if they can have an education program, they do, and a lot of them use my book, so that there's a consistent message throughout the country.
So that really is just a very, very quick look around. There's so many businesses, for example, Superior Chunky. Now, they're a little outfit in Geraldine who are selling dog food that doesn't have to be refrigerated because they've got a secret recipe. Everywhere you look at the South Island Field Days Kirwee, there's something which you really do want to look at, talk about, and actually get to know more about. But sadly, it's going to take more than the time that we had. I'm Rob Cope-Williams. You've either been watching or you've just missed the special from the South Island Field Days Kirwee. But I will be back the same time next week with a more traditional On the Land. Until then, bye now.